to the club.
Welcome back, everybody, for another edition of the Club Cool podcast. I am your host, Barrett Dudley, and I'm here in the Washed Media Studios. We are brought to you, of course, by Washed Media. And joining me on this lovely November day on the other side of the table, it's Mr. Phil Battaglia. What's good, Phil?
Hey, dude.
What's going on?
Chilling.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Chilling out, maxing?
Yep.
Relaxing, all cool?
Mm-hmm.
Good show for you today. Obviously, there's been some big fashion news. Supreme. Got bought, baby.
Big time.
Yeah.
Two billy.
Ain't nothing but a
2.1.
2.1.
Can't forget that point.
Don't forget that, because that's like $100 million.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Don't forget about that extra, nine figures there, right? Did I do that math right? Nine figures? That's nine figures.
Yeah.
It is. Good job by me. I want to talk a little bit about some different eras of style, because I've been watching The Queen's Gambit on Netflix.
Mm.
And then in the last segment today, I'm going to give you a rundown of my tips for selling clothes online, specifically on Grailed, but these rules, these guidelines will apply to all of your various marketplaces. But first, last week we got on the podcast and we did like a little early Black Friday preview.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked about, we each had items from John Elliott on our list. And typically John Elliott has always done kind of a big Black Friday blowout with like site-wide sales and extra discount on top of discount. They'll run these little flash sales. They've got exclusive product that they build out just for Black Friday. It's like a whole big thing. It's kind of it's been their one place where they've really done site-wide sales. Over the course of the pandemic, it looks like they have shifted that strategy a little bit, and they are now pushing all of those sales to these online sample sale hosts, basically. Earlier in the year, there was one hosted by like Eclipse Online, which does it for a bunch of different brands. And then we named two items here on the podcast, got home, and like the next thing we knew, there was another sample sale. There was another big sale from John Elliott on something called 260.
Who knew?
And the items that we wanted were there for prices that we liked.
Thanks to you. I had no clue.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's what I'm here for.
Man, that was huge.
So, I balked. I bailed.
You bailed?
Yeah. The denim that I wanted, I looked at them more closely.
Uh-huh.
They were very expensive retail price. So even with the, you know, I was waiting for like that additional 40% off or whatever to put them in a range that I was comfortable with, because I wasn't totally sure on this wash. It was like a nice blue, but it was very like high and low contrasty. Wasn't sure about the whiskering, like some of the, you know, the distressing across the front, specifically in the crotch region.
Yeah.
And so I said, no, there's too much coming down the pipeline for the rest of November. I'm holding on to my ruples. You, on the other hand, you finally pulled trig.
Finally.
On a big Grail item.
Yeah, I got the rider jacket is en route, strangely enough, from Australia.
Yeah.
We were just talking about this.
Yeah.
And I don't understand.
I don't either, because typically John Elliott ships everything out of their warehouse in LA.
Uh-huh.
And with the one that was earlier this year with Eclipse, like they had basically just moved all of their product over to Eclipse, and Eclipse handed all of the distribution and all of the the packaging and shipping out, essentially. So it was like almost like a drop ship type deal, or a consignment, where Eclipse you give us all the inventory, we'll deal with the rest. I expected this one to be similar, and yet your jacket shipped
from Australia,
from the
understand.
Other side of the world.
It is in customs, according to them, yesterday in San Francisco. So I'm watching closely.
I guess it's possible that there were some products online that they were selling that were existing at other retailers. Like, had they gathered up all the John Elliott from both John Elliott's site and warehouse and also leftover product from some of their global, you know?
I don't know, man. I sure hope
retail?
That I don't get screwed again.
You having flashbacks to the Barney sale?
And the difference with this is, though, it's already gone through the transaction.
Oh, it's on its way, baby.
Yeah.
I think like the worst thing that could happen is that you open up the box and it's like the pink one.
Oh, anything. I wouldn't be surprised with anything, Barrett, if there's like a huge slash across the back of it.
Like the back panel is just cut because it was just a sample. It's just like cut with scissors.
Oh, man. I've gotten some packages in the recent days that have been just totally fucked.
Beaten to shit. Yes.
Completely.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this is like home stuff.
Yeah, well, that stuff always, it's so heavy. Yeah. It's always so heavy.
So they're just throwing that shit, throwing stuff on top of it.
Yeah. But even with some of the just the regular clothes and shoes and stuff.
Yeah.
The mailing system, whether it's UPS or FedEx or USPS, they're under a lot of stress.
They are.
At the moment.
Yeah.
I had on like 60 Minutes popped up this past weekend.
Uh-huh.
And
that's my show.
Or maybe it was last weekend. Do you always watch it?
Yeah.
Well, so did you see them talking about the FedEx? They were interviewing like the FedEx guy. And they're basically like the next 6 weeks of shipping and delivery is basically going to be like Black Friday, Christmas shopping,
right,
and Amazon Prime Day all combined into one massive shitstorm.
And he seemed pretty calm too.
He did. He seemed very calm. I guess you can't not be calm. You have to. Look, when this all started, online shopping obviously really ramped up. Mm-hmm. The stock for Amazon blew through the roof even further, and a lot of people that were selling goods online didn't notice. Depending on what you know, kind of industry or arena you were in, you didn't drop off too badly.
Mm-hmm.
Like sales were continuing to be made; they were just all moving online.
Yeah.
So they've had several months to kind of, I think, forecast that this was probably going to be just an absolute incredible nightmare. And so I actually have a package. It's a birthday gift for Laura that was here in Austin. You know, you're tracking it. You're following its every move, as we do. And it was here in Austin yesterday. And it was just like, delivery's delayed a day. And it's, you know, that's because they have so many packages.
Wow.
That there's just now a backlog. So stuff is just sitting at its destination location.
Uh-huh.
It's just, there's no room on the truck. There's no time in the day to deliver every package that was able to be delivered yesterday.
And I always feel so terrible for the delivery driver that's still grinding it out. You see him out there at
8:45,
8:45, 9 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
You know, the last packages that got tucked away in that corner. And these guys, like the same UPS driver will come through our complex like 2 and 3 times a day. I don't understand that really.
Yeah, but that's weird.
I think it may have something to do with the way the truck's packed.
Yeah. Maybe a pickup, maybe a drop off.
I don't know.
Maybe an express versus a ground. Yeah, I don't know.
And then USPS, talk about some pressure. They've got to handle the ballots.
Yeah. Yeah, they do.
All those fake ballots.
All
they
the
got
fake ballots.
Submitted.
They're just millions of them, is what I'm hearing.
Can you believe it?
No.
All these people were willing and able to risk that federal crime, that federal penitentiary crime, just to get Biden in the office.
Well, there's a whole network of them. You know, it's a vast and
that's the risk you got to take.
Tangled conspiracy theory. So that's, you know, that stuff happens. Yeah. We all know 9/11 was an inside job.
Absolutely. God.
So yeah, but it's very exciting. We're definitely gonna have to get you in here. Doing some twirls, fashion show.
Yeah, I will.
We'll get you. You'll have to. We'll you know, check out YouTube.com. We'll cut the clip. We'll put it on the Grom because.
Add me on the group.
At Club Cool Pod, and yeah, man, we got to see you in this thing. This has been on your list for quite some time.
Look, man, I'm very excited, but I'm cautiously optimistic that this thing will come and be exactly what.
Yeah. Well, it was a nice find because you needed a very specific size.
Yes.
And you had the price in mind, and then here it was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Half off, you know the price when you see it, right? We're not going to see the 50% off again. I mean,
right.
You might.
Yeah.
But I wasn't going to bet on it.
Yeah. No, that's and that was smart.
Yeah.
Speaking of gifts and packages and getting stuff for other people and getting stuff for yourself, it's time to talk about today's sponsor, which is Hawthorne.
Ooh.
Because whether you're treating yourself or shopping for someone on your list, finding the right holiday gift, it's never easy. But this holiday season, Hawthorne is making gift giving fun and simple. Hawthorne is the premium tailored personal care brand that's making it easy for guys to feel and smell their best. You start with their quiz, and they ask you things like, what's your favorite drink? How do you like to spend a night out? Do you smoke? What type of hair do you have? What type of skin do you have? What are you looking for in life?
Nobody asks these questions.
Nobody asks these questions except for Hawthorne. You gotta know this stuff. Right. And it's actually really easy, and it's fun. I'm a big quiz guy. I just like taking quizzes. Hawthorne wants to get to know me, and I'm happy to share what I'm all about. You know, I like establishing this personal relationship with my personal care brand. So it's actually very fun, and you can do that for yourself, but there's also a gift quiz right now as well. If you go to Hawthorne.co, you're going to see that gift tab, and you can go take a quiz on behalf of somebody, basically.
I see.
And whether you're out, you know, you know your dad, you know your brother, right. You know your significant other. This is, you can answer a few questions on their behalf. You're not going to mess it up. Don't worry about that.
No.
Look, the products are all amazing. I have a full, you know, a bathroom repertoire, basically. I got everything on the list. I got the face cleanser, the lotions, shampoo, conditioner, bath gel, and, you know, it just could not forget, but I gotta talk again about these candles.
Oh, yeah, they're good.
Right? Because, they're good. I mean, look, go for the full gift package. Take the quiz. Get somebody fully kitted out. But, you know, even for ladies in your life, or for some maybe an acquaintance or a coworker, you don't want to do. You're not going to give them an entire basket full of bath and body products, right? What you're going to give them is a beautiful, minimal, delightful smelling candle, whether it's pear and basil marine,
ooh,
or warm and bitter citrus of etiquette, or just something warm and woody and wintry like Frank's Chop Shop. I mean, there's so many to choose from. You really can't go wrong. Can't go wrong. It's very tempting to just add all of them to cart. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And just go ham on the candles.
Yeah.
But it's all deadly. Hawthorne is fun. It's a convenient way to get super high quality products tailored specifically for men. Hawthorne even takes the risk out of it by giving you free shipping on your order and returns. So do not worry about that. You're not going to have to pay shipping. And if something doesn't work out quite like you think it is, free returns as well. You're going to get something that you love. Look, they'll even retailor them based on your feedback. You get this candle, you say, oh, no, too woody. Boom. They send you the one that you like better.
I like that.
Yeah. It's risk-free shopping. Mm-hmm. It never ends with Hawthorne. It's good, one good thing after another.
Yes.
So get special offers for the holidays. They're going on right now. Visit Hawthorne.co. That's Hawthorne.co to check out their special holiday offers. Take care of everybody on your list with all of this great product from Hawthorne, Hawthorne.co. Okay, Phil, let's talk about the big fashion news, right? That's what we're leading off with today. Supreme was acquired by VF Brands for $2.1 billion. Now, Here's the baseline. Half of Supreme was already owned by a venture capital firm called the Carlyle Group. So they had already...
Good for them.
They had already semi-sold out.
Man.
Right? But they still owned half as well. And on account of this sale, I believe the entire business is now owned by VF Brand. So this is the full securing the bag, collect the check, we done.
And think about it. What's so mind-blowing is $2.1 billion, they feel like they can unlock much more value. It's like buying a home and assuming that later on down the road it's going to appreciate. How do you appreciate from $2.1 billion?
Yeah, let's see. The companies, VF expects Supreme to contribute at least $500 million of revenue in the 2022 fiscal year. And I've seen some other numbers are that I think Supreme does a couple hundred million in a year, maybe, is one of the revenue numbers that I saw. Or that's a revenue number that they have achieved already at some point.
You know what was shocking is I didn't realize how few of brick and mortar stores that they had.
Yeah.
What is it, like 12?
Something like that. Yeah. Yeah. No, it's
low. They're going to crank those out.
You think they're going to start putting more Supremes?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Supreme in Denver, Supreme in Houston.
They were
Supreme
talking
in...
on MSNBC with the CEO of VF, and he was talking about how China is the big target.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense.
Because I think they're only in, as far as Asia is concerned, well, they're in Japan. And then Europe, two stores in Europe, he said.
Mm-hmm. Mostly Paris in the U.S. and in Japan, as well as one in Paris and one in London.
Uh-huh.
And, yeah, so, wait, where was it? Didn't we talk about, like, 6-7 months ago? There's that whole, I think it's in Shanghai. There's an entire fake Supreme store. Like, everything. Like, big box logo and neon lights. Like, it is a legit store selling all fake Supreme. With all the Supreme.
I love it.
Yeah.
They had that Yeezy store there, too.
They're going to go in there and clear that out and put in a real one is probably what's going to happen. Anyways, the $500 million in sales is important, I think, because generally I feel like with clothing brands, I want to say that it's typically like a 4X multiplier.
Mm.
Like your company is worth about four times what your revenue is.
Yeah.
And that, of course, depends on like what your bottom line looks like and what your books look like and how much staff you have and how much overhead and how many brick and mortars you're running, how much rent you're paying. Mm-hmm. You can definitely get into trouble with that, like we saw with Outdoor Voices earlier this year. And so they paid a premium because they're paying that 4X on what they're projecting for 2022.
Mm-hmm.
But that makes sense when you're buying such a one of the biggest name brands in the world with Supreme here. I think the question for Supreme going forward and the question that everybody is asking is like kind of what this does to Supreme's cachet, if you will. Now, I think that they'd lost a lot of like their cult coolness already.
Yes.
They've certainly, you know, they've shifted to doing bigger and bigger numbers. And more products. They are churning out collaborations left and right. A lot of the collaborations feel lazy in general. They just, it's Supreme and the S logo slapped on wherever they can find to put it on there, right?
Yeah.
Like,
it's not exciting at all.
It's the Nike stuff was really underwhelming this last season. And I mean, they're just, it's, I don't know, like how many, and then with on the accessories front, it's like how many different things can you put the logo on? We got Oreos, we got Ziploc bags, we got
generators,
we got wrenches, we got motorcycles, we got Jacob watches. I mean, it's like, I guess you could just go down the list and literally, you know, microphones with Supreme on them.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I was going to say water bottles, but they've done a million water bottles already, whether it's Nalgene or Stanley or whoever they were doing with the thermoses and what have you. I don't know. It's just neither you or I are buying Supreme. I get the emails. I typically go look at a drop. There's like this really, really like simple work shirt that came out today that's like $130. I considered it. I don't own any Supreme. And it just kind of feels like now's not the time to start.
Right.
The ship has sailed essentially. So I don't really envision myself ever grabbing something off the website. And as we've talked about before, a lot of the negative connotation that we have with the brand is that it is exclusively for the youth and especially for resellers.
Yeah.
So it's like if this is in a lot of ways, I get the sense that Supreme is like what Abercrombie was for me in a way that they, you know, we were getting the catalogs and like circling the stuff we wanted and then like getting, you know, going with our parents to shop and like spending our part-time job money there. Yeah. And like, you know, so it wasn't the same. There wasn't as much focus on online shopping and certainly wasn't any hype around Abercrombie, but it was that same way that we were very focused on a particular brand and we were engaged with that brand, whether it was through print or in-person shopping or talking about it or, you know, everybody wanted the bags with the sexy people on them. You know, there was a lot going on there.
Yes.
And so that's what it feels like for me is that for the young kids now, they like the brand. They like wearing the brand just like we did with Abercrombie, but there's that other layer where it's like, it's a game to see if you can get through, to see if you can buy it, to see if you need a bot, to see if you can go manual.
Mm-hmm.
All these terms that are thrown around, like people are having their little side gigs, buying and selling Supreme. And so it's just it will just be interesting to see what happens. VF Brands owns a lot of the brands that Supreme already collaborates with. Vans, Timberland, Dickies. and the North Face
yeah.
as well. And so, are they just going to continue? Is that going to ramp up even further? Are they going to do even more collaborations? Are they going to bump up those numbers a little bit to try to sell more and more units?
You got to think they're going to produce more.
Does the brand even exist if it's not selling out every product? You know what I mean? Like, imagine a Supreme where everything is available for a week on the website. They don't start selling out of sizes until a week after the drop.
Maybe they do the pre-sale stuff.
Nah.
No. It's the box logo, man. For me, that's the only thing that still has my attention. And I think that if that was available widely, I think those would still go.
I mean, there's a number that they could produce where they wouldn't.
Yeah.
But you're right. But they could, alternatively, that the box logo stuff could be the one thing that they hold on to really tightly.
Yeah.
And continue to produce very limited numbers of. Mm-hmm. And in the meantime, they open up the, you know, they open up the kimono and let it fly with the other stuff.
And that stuff already stays on the website, though. The stuff that nobody really wants.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
So what are you going to do?
I don't know. Here's another question. You've shopped on Supreme's web store, right?
Yeah.
It's shitty.
Yeah.
It's a shitty user experience.
The shirts are shitty. I have one shirt.
But I just mean from it's not easy to shop.
No.
You have to hit back a million times, and then it all goes back to the front.
Uh-huh.
There's no there's no natural, easy, intuitive way mm-hmm. to scroll the products. Like, is that going
to
change?
It has to. I think that was designed that way for a reason.
It is.
Just like when you go into
the store.
It's
part of it. It's
nobody. You feel like you're imposing on somebody's
house.
Yeah,
it's like people at a store being assholes to you, right? It's like one of those weird things. You're like, wait, is this part of it?
It is.
And it is.
That's right.
But I don't know. Is there any other, does Supreme want to be Vans?
You know, that's a good point, because Vans is still got that.
VF owns Vans, by the way.
Yeah. And they're still cool.
Right.
But they crank out, like Converse.
Yep.
Crank that stuff out. Not that those were sought after, selling out items that I'm aware of.
Mm-hmm.
But that's one way to you know, drive revenue. I can't think of anything else other than cranking out numbers.
I mean, well, I think you said the biggest thing. I think expansion into new markets, is probably
yes.
where they really think that they're going to get that the bulk of that number from, the bulk of the increase.
But does China block their site? I mean, surely those kids are able to get online and buy the stuff.
I think they are, but I think they're going to make it a lot easier
uh-huh.
going forward.
Yeah.
And like you said, I don't think there's a Supreme store in China.
No.
I bet there's going to be.
Ooh. You better believe it.
So.
Are they not in Korea?
I don't think so.
Whew.
And Seoul. Seoul
Good
could
God.
Use one.
They could use about 300.
So, yeah. It was probably, I think this move makes sense. Because all these think pieces are saying, this was Supreme was no longer the cool, low-key skater brand anyway.
No.
It very much is already a mass marketing machine. You know, its biggest asset is the hype, right?
Mm-hmm.
The fact that it has people locked in on weekly drops. So do they try to hold on to that, or do they focus more on bumping up those revenue numbers with more and more products and by making it easier to shop? Would they do wholesale?
I don't know, dude.
Supreme pop-up at Nordstrom coming soon?
I mean, you know, Vans.
Noah just did one.
Do they really?
Noah did a Nordstrom.
At Nordstrom?
Yeah, a pop-in at Nordstrom and exclusive product.
You know what? It would make sense to do it very tight, by George.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Although, think about how that doesn't work out. By George selling Rolexes and then these t-shirts.
They sell Stussy.
I know, but I don't know.
They sell Saturdays.
Yeah. But Saturdays is more elevated than Stussy.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. But it's not it's not all Brunello Cucinelli and...
Right.
And,
yeah, yeah.
Bottega Veneta.
I'll never forget. This is a terrible example, but just while we're on the subject, there was this really nice men's store in Beaumont at Parkdale Mall, which is just filed for bankruptcy. The men's store.
R.I.P.
The men's store is long gone. But it was like the destination if you wanted to go get a nice suit. They had tailors in there, everything. They would make your do your shirts in there, shoes, everything. And then you could go in there and get Lacoste, Polo, Ralph Lauren. I walked in there one day. This is towards the end. And they had a rack of those NASCAR jackets.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
The real loud color. And I was like, this is it? This is the end. Sure enough, they
That's
were gone.
That's when you knew.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I didn't make it over there for the clearance sale to get one, but I regret that.
Yeah. Oh, let's see. This is
Kurt Busch.
Man, they've done studies. They've done focus groups. They did one made up of 148 members of Reddit's streetwear community.
Ooh. Why weren't you asked into that?
I don't know. I'm not I don't post enough on Reddit.
I don't understand Reddit at all.
They should have gotten into the Club Cool Discord.
Seriously.
That's what they should have done.
Yeah.
That's the focus group that everybody wants right now.
I mean, that's a highly educated group.
By the way, special November favor.
What?
Listen here, listeners. I'm going to drop the Discord link, which lasts for about 24 hours.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to put it right in the description of the podcast today.
Wow.
So you don't even have to go follow Patreon.
Beautiful.
Now, this is a special early Black Friday treat to make it easy for more and more people to get in the Discord because it's popping off in there. Mm-hmm. There are some real firecrackers in there, too. So come in there ready, but we're posting links, we're doing sales, we're doing trend
cocktails.
Talk, we're doing cocktails, people are posting
wine.
What food they're cooking, wine.
I need to be more active in there, and especially with the wine, because it's the holidays. This is when you really let it go. Spend the money on the nice stuff.
Yeah. How does the wine game change? Do people stop buying white come November?
No. We sell rosé constantly. Right
really?
Now. Yeah. It's
yeah.
crazy.
Okay.
One thing that the Beaujolais season is kind of on the rise. We don't have a huge selection of that, mm-hmm. but I'm really into it right
I like
now.
A good Beaujolais. Very
Ooh.
Light.
It's great, man.
Drinkable.
Yeah. And there's some American producers doing Gamay that is...
Yeah. Mm. Chef's kiss emoji.
Yep. You can have that with fish, by the way. That's another thing.
Oh, yeah.
It's a red wine, but it's just barely...
I mean, I'll mess around and do a Pinot with fish.
Ooh. Yeah, fuck it.
Don't think I won't.
Yeah.
So that Discord, here's the thing. The Discord, there's a lot of people in there now. And I'm going to have to cap it at some point, and it's probably going to become a Patreon exclusive feature.
Mm-hmm.
That's why you need to get in there now, before the fiscal year of 2021. Because much like Supreme in the fiscal year of 2022, we're projecting 500 million Discord users next year.
Well, we're in talks with this. I'm gonna, you know, with somebody to come buy out the podcast.
That's right. That's right. I'll sell it for 1 billion.
That's a good deal.
Yeah. You can also, of course, go check us out on patreon.com/clubcool. Where I know I always say this, I'm not gonna release this pod. When this podcast is released, there will be a new editorial up. November's watch list, best Ooh. Stuff on the internet. It's going to be out. When this podcast comes out, that will be out. So you can go to patreon.com/clubcool and join. I'll include the refresh Discord link in that as well. That's the easiest place to get it as well. It's $2 a month. You know, treat yourself. It's the holidays. It's $2 a month. It's
Ask
nothing.
Santa Claus for it.
Yeah, put it on your it's Christmas list.
Great
it's,
Christmas.
It's much. It's a much better gift than coal, even though, you know, well. It just is.
I was waiting on a really good punchline.
Yeah, I didn't. I had the train of thought, and then it just.
Oh well, that's all right.
Couldn't land it.
You didn't rehearse that.
So one. Discord, the link will be in the podcast description. Patreon, new editorial is up right now. Patreon.com/clubcool. Go check it out. Let's see what's next on the list. Oh yeah, okay. So I want to talk about. I'm watching this show on Netflix called The Queen's Gambit. I'm not much of a binge watcher, but this is one that has I've just been attached to, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And we started this past weekend, and we have there's seven episodes. We're already through five. And that's a lot of – that's I don't go through shows that quick. I like to savor them, you know?
Damn. See, I'll go.
This one, very, very just addictive. I want to see it very quickly. And it is set in the 60s. And I just love that era.
Oh, fuck. The 50s, too. I love it.
So, and one of the coolest things about, I think one of the main things that I love about watching, seeing the 60s kind of, you know, conveyed and portrayed in entertainment is that commercial travel was very new at this point. And this show, like, takes you to Mexico City, takes you to Las Vegas, takes you to Paris. And so you get to see all of these places kind of like almost in their original tourist form.
Wouldn't that be cool?
Right? And so I like, we go to, and it just got me thinking about if you could travel, but you could go to different eras. I guess some people would call this time travel. I would, I, like, the 60s, that's where I'm going. I'm going 60s Vegas.
You are?
I want to see the Strip.
You're going to 60s Vegas.
Before it was the Strip. Yeah. I'll watch out for my cabeza, but, you know, I don't want to go, I don't want to be taken into any back rooms.
That would be something. Get to go see Sinatra.
Yeah. But it's just, it's so cool. And then, like, and Mexico City looks fabulous.
Yeah.
Just before all the, like, this was pre-cartel, right? You watch these Narcos, Blow. That's all, that's 70s and 80s stuff,
see,
right?
You could, get there in the 60s, establish your cartel.
That's right. That's like buying Apple stock.
Man.
But,
Randy liked that one.
As far as the fits go, too, it's a great style era. A
lot of hats.
Yeah.
I haven't seen it.
I'm actually, not that many men's hats.
Okay.
More women's hats, I feel like. Some really funky women's hats. Excellent women's style. And okay, and good men's style. The 50s, 60s stuff is very, it ties into like what I, the kind of, the handmade vintage feel of the stuff like Bodie.
Yes.
Right? With the camp collars and the boxier fits and the high-waisted trousers and like all that type of stuff. The kind of, and that old school kind of university prep. I don't know. It's just very, very cool. And I'm loving watching the era. And I just wanted to, get your take on any other eras of that you would travel through time to see.
I love the 50s, man. I really do. We were in Beaumont last weekend and doing a little cruise around town at some of, my dad was showing us some old places they used to live back in the day and how their childhood home, the Barnum Bailey brothers, isn't that right?
Barnum Circus. And, yeah. Barnum and Bailey? And Barnum?
Yeah, they lived on the tracks.
Barnum and Barnum?
They would park the rail cars right there behind the house, have all the animals there. You know, everybody from around town would come and watch them move all the animals out on these, like, buggies and like that were horse-driven, apparently. I don't know. I wasn't expecting that.
Barnum and Bailey.
Barnum and Bailey.
Ringling Brothers.
I don't know. The 50s, just, to me, that would be so much fun. Also, we were talking about this last night. To jump ahead, the late 60s, early 70s.
Yeah.
Go to Woodstock.
Yeah. It's kind of, you can almost split the 60s in half, I think.
Yeah.
And put the early part of the decade with the 50s and then the latter part of the decade into kind of the 70s.
Yeah. That makes sense.
It's more like 55 to 65, 65 to 75, I feel like.
Right. So the 50s would be cool for just that era of time.
Mm-hmm.
The war's over. Everybody's, right. And, you know, I guess they're doing well. They're doing better than they were.
It also makes me think, like, watching this stuff, how as we continue into the information and the technology age and your screen time just continues to tick up and up and up and you're constantly, like, inundated with stuff in your face. Mm-hmm. You know, you watch a show like Westworld where it's like, you know, you go back into the West, right? You're at this immersive theme park. And people do a little bit of this now where they take a vacation to quote unquote unplug. But I just wonder if there will ever be this sense of or this option to travel to do something where you really throw it back. And there's like, I don't know how immersive you could make this.
That's a great idea.
But you know, yeah. Like where you're in a place and everything is there are no cell phones. There is no internet. You have to go analog for everything. You have to get maps. You have to ask people for directions. You have to ask where stuff is. You have to you go see a maitre d' at a restaurant to make a reservation, or you have to track down the phone number. Like,
I love it.
You know what I mean?
Palm Springs.
Like stuff.
Check that place out.
I don't know. I think that I don't know how that would work, but it's certainly it sounds cool. It sounds like something that people would be attracted to now. It sounds good to me.
There's definitely options to unplug because there's no internet at some places, but that's about as far as they take it.
Yeah.
But Palm Springs, I've never been, but I look at the real estate constantly.
Mm-hmm.
There's homes on the market today that look like it's the original owners from the 60s.
Right, right, yeah.
And yeah, that fits in
perfectly to the, like, that look.
Yeah, and it's pristine, nice. Even though it's shag carpet,
yeah,
old appliances, it looks beautiful.
Right.
You know what I mean? It fits the era.
A lot of beautiful mid-century modern furniture in this show, by the way. Dude, just like in those Palm Springs homes. You get on the flights, man. Like, they're giving you martinis in a glass coupe.
You're smoking cigs.
There's one. They're showing this one scene where people are drinking their martinis, or what does she call it? It's the one with the little onion in it instead of an olive, which is actually called something else.
Okay,
I can't remember what it's called. And they're eating, you know, this nice meal on the plane. There's Brussels sprouts involved in the meal. So you got the martini with the onion in it, the Brussels sprouts, and the dude behind him is smoking a cigarette.
Love it.
These planes must have, you know, boy, they just smelled wonderful with all of that going on.
You'd be smoking cigs on there, wouldn't you?
I'd be doing everything.
Yeah.
And you're telling me that, like, I guarantee you have more leg room then, too.
Absolutely. Not everybody can afford to fly back in those days.
Right. I just, it's very... I don't know. It watching this show, I feel like it's the first time where I've really gotten this almost like a nostalgia for something that I wasn't alive for.
I have that.
And I know a lot of people have that. Oh, the good old days.
Well, yeah, and that's back to what I was talking about earlier, is just the way that they lived their lives back in those days was simpler, and for better or for worse, you didn't have access to a lot of information, but you relied on the people around you. There was more of a sense of community.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Definitely, definitely.
This podcast is off the rails.
Yeah, let's get into how bad Facebook is for the entire world. Yeah, so just highly suggest The Queen's Gambit, by the way. Very,
all right,
very good kind of prodigy, fish out of water, human interest story, all about chess, actually. You know how to play chess?
No.
No?
Mm-mm. I'm not interested, Barrett.
No, okay.
I don't want to learn that. Chess. I've tried it back in the day, and it's like video games. If I'm not good at it, I'm out. I don't care.
I know how to play chess, but I certainly don't know any of the moves or the strategies.
Yeah.
I can sit down on a board, and I know how to move the pieces.
Okay.
That's about it.
That's the first step.
Yeah, it is. Might have to bust out a chessboard after this. Okay. Any other eras that we should mention here? I mean, the 80s would be cool, but there's nothing... The 80s are not a romantic decade.
Uh-huh.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
The 60s, very much so. Everything about them is just like, it's like this old world thing that's just,
and again,
doesn't exist anymore.
Early 70s, the music scene would have been really something.
Yeah. Okay, last segment of the day. Are you ready for my tips and tricks of the trade for selling on Grailed?
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Tell us more.
So this was a requested segment, and so if you don't want the tutorial, a lecture, from Professor Barrett, you can turn it off now. But look, people talk about Grailed, and I always hear about these negative experiences, right? People are constantly getting like short shrifted or scammed or having bad experiences with buyers who then say they didn't get the product, or sellers that flake, and like all this type of stuff. And the selling experience for me is certainly not perfect by any means, but, and I'm knocking on wood here, I'm bound to have a horrible experience here just by doing this segment, but I'm up to like 200 sales on Grailed alone.
Are you really?
Yeah. And I have never had a major issue.
What, on the sale side?
From me selling. I've never had anybody unhappy with a product. Mm-hmm. I've never had a chargeback. I've never had I've never dealt with somebody trying to scam me on buying. Well, I'll amend that. One time somebody bought a very expensive product that I had, and within an hour I had a PayPal like notice that was like fraud had been claimed on this purchase, which was interesting because I still had the money.
Mm-hmm.
I had to go in there and like click refund basically. So there you can, and I mean, I was lucky that I hadn't shipped this pair of shoes.
He had claimed fraud on his on your behalf?
I had it was the Travis Scott sixes that I eventually moved on StockX, but like I had them listed on Grailed. Somebody did the buy it now price, which was a lot. And, you know, the money came into my PayPal account. I had the shipping address. The shoes were ready to go. And thank God I didn't ship them super, super fast.
Yeah.
Because within a couple hours, there was like that charge, that PayPal charge had been flagged. And so I don't know if somebody had broken into somebody's PayPal account and like, you know, messed around with some stuff and was trying to get the shoes by using somebody else's credit card, or if it was that person. They were trying to do the thing where, like,
you ship it, and then
where I ship it, they've already said, nope, I didn't do that,
right?
And then the shoes show up anyway, right? So that was my closest call.
Okay,
but all the other stuff, it's never really happened to me. So
okay, that's good.
It's bound to happen eventually, but it hasn't yet. So I'll run you through some of the things that I think about when I'm selling on Grailed and eBay here. The first thing is, You are basically running a business here.
Yes.
You are operating a little, your own little archival vintage shop, and that's the way you have to treat it. So all of your communication, the way that you write descriptions, the way that you talk to people on messages, the way that you, like, you know, frame everything should be very professional. Write a nice paragraph. Give details. Use punctuation. In capital letters and periods and like formatting, right? This is not a tweet.
Mm-hmm.
And the same goes for like when you're messaging people. A lot of young people on Grailed, a lot of young people out there. So you will get messages from buyers that are in all lowercase will say, bro, what's the lowest you'll go? No punctuation, U'LL.
Mm-hmm.
Right? There's a lot of that out there.
Yeah. And bro.
Hey, bro, what's the lowest you'll go? Hey, this still for sale, bro? There's a lot of that out there. And you don't go down to that level because it's not a swap meet.
Yeah.
You gotta operate it like you are running a business. And that's the best way to weed out, to let people know that you're serious too. That nobody's gonna get one over on you. Mm-hmm. Nobody that you've been doing this, you know what you're doing, you're not a kid, right? Okay, let's go to photos. Natural light is key. I do not take any photos of any products that I put online at nighttime.
Yeah.
You gotta find the right light, undo the blinds a little bit when the sun's at the right angle, not blaring through the windows, but it's light outside. Let some come in. If your overhead lights are too yellow or your lamps are too yellow or blue or whatever, turn them off. Just use natural light. And then... you'll either some stuff you want to hang, some stuff you want laid out on a solid or neutral background.
Mm-hmm.
So that can be your sheets or your bedspread or a wood floor or a clean carpet, something like that. But you want a nice background. Some stuff looks good on the ground. Other stuff looks good hung up. Take some photos both ways. Decide which ones look better. Post those.
You don't ever put them on and take a photo of yourself. Fit pic.
I only do that when somebody asks for a fit pic.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's. Because it's generally not going to look like, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it's about the professionalism.
Yeah.
And so you with like a mirror selfie on the listing is like not exactly what you want to see if you're shopping, you're looking for. And this all boils down to like for the buyers, you're trying to make them as comfortable as possible. Because what's the worry when you're buying on Grailed? That you're not going to get what's pictured,
yep.
That the item isn't clean or well taken care of, right? That that somebody has taken pictures of it new and then worn it a bunch, all that type of stuff. So you're just trying to calm those people's nerves. I mentioned the description. Be as detailed as possible. And this kind of goes to the photos as well. But if you can go find the original stock image, include that in the photos.
They'll let you do that on Grailed?
Yeah.
Huh.
And pull the description from the webpage. If that's still up, you can include your own words, but just pull the actual description and post that on there. Measurements. You need a soft tape measure. They're like $4 on Amazon. And Grailed now has the function where it's actually one of the screens that when you're going through, like, there's description, but then there is measurements.
Yeah.
And so it makes it very easy for you to just plug them in. Mm. But that's huge, too, because people always want measurements, but it's a barrier. So if they are, you know, if you don't have them up, not everybody's going to take the time to ask and then wait for a response. It's just much easier to just have that listed. I mentioned the photos of your clothes, so we can talk about presentation now. I get a lot of packages in. If I get a nice plastic bag from a brand, and if I get tissue paper, Mr. Porter, Essence, right? There's all Barney's. There's always the white or the brown tissue paper. Mm-hmm. You bring home something from Stag, you get the nice mm-hmm. armadillo tissue paper. I keep it.
Good idea.
All of it. Mm-hmm. When I sell something, when I ship it, I make sure that it's steamed. I lint roll the shit out of it. I fold it up like I work in a store. I put it in tissue paper, and then I put it in one of the little plastic bags as protection.
That's high quality service. And also, side note, Barrett gave me a box of items before he put it on Grailed for me to sift through. These things were folded like you were back in your Nordstrom days or By George.
My By George days.
Everything was so perfectly crisp, folded. You know, I didn't even have to. I just opened the box. I could see everything right there.
Yeah, and I mean, I know I have the advantage because I've done that, and I know how to do it. But I've bought a few things on Grailed, and it typically ships like loose in a bag with no thought put mm-hmm. towards it. And that's the type of thing where you're asking for somebody to be unhappy.
Yeah,
because if it's not packaged well, if it's not presented well, and then they pull it out and something's wrong with it, you pull out that poorly packaged item, you're already in the mindset that something's going to be wrong. Mm-hmm. Totally different experience if it's wrapped like they just bought something from a store.
Right.
If it's protected, if it's clean and steamed and doesn't have dirt and lint on it. So again, this is just like this all falls into the big idea here, which is that you're operating a little business. Mm-hmm. And then shipping. You're going to get the money through PayPal, and strangely, I don't think everybody knows this, but when you go to your PayPal, you click through PayPal, and you have the option to ship directly through PayPal.
Hmm.
This is the best way to do it for a couple reasons. You get a discount on USPS shipping, and it's the only way to ship first class, which is for any package under a pound, without going to the post office.
You print it right there.
You can print it right there. Here's what else you'll need to do this accurately, though. You need a little scale because you got to weigh.
Yeah.
You need to know the accurate weight of mm-hmm. your packages. And then you're going to use that soft tape measure so that you can measure the box or the package as well. Mm-hmm. And then you go right through there. It prints out. You tape it to the package. Get yourself some nice, good, clear shipping tape. That's what you're packing everything
what
up in.
What are you packing in? You have boxes that you've purchased for this?
No. So just like I hold on to like the tissue paper and the plastic like garment bags that the garments come in. If a box is good, I keep it.
Okay.
I don't keep every box. Otherwise I'd have a garage full of boxes.
Yeah. Now you're a hoarder.
I keep a stash of good boxes.
Okay.
And you'll know the ones that are
good. Yeah.
You don't want the big ass ones because that's gonna weigh too much. Mm-hmm. You don't want something too small because then you're gonna have to fold something up too many times to get it in there. The bubble wrap bags that you get from Amazon are good to reuse.
Those are good.
Anything that ships in like one of the little like lightweight shipping bags, mm-hmm. if you can keep it in relatively good shape when you cut it open, basically, I reuse those too because that's the best way to get the package weight down mm-hmm. and shipping costs less. So those are really my tenets there. That's treat it like a business. Describe your product well. Take good photos in natural light. Clean your item. Steam it. Lint roll it. Pack it well. Ship it quickly. Communicate with your buyers like you're writing an email to your boss, basically.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a nice little handwritten letter with each one?
I do not. I do not go with the Pat Allen from Uniform. I don't do the personal note.
Spray a little Hawthorne in there.
I do, yeah.
I'll give a little. Good.
Maybe write on the tissue paper. You know, I don't want to. I don't want to.
Yeah.
I don't want to drench the garment. but a nice little aroma from the Hawthorne. Probably the play.
Yes, because these
clothes are for fun.
Yeah.
You know?
I have to break in here. Breaking news. The package is clear customs.
Oh, my God.
It's in San Francisco, received by the postal carrier. So now it's going to, I think, transfer to probably UPS or somebody.
Yeah. Man.
We're cleared.
If that was DHL, you'd be getting this baby tomorrow.
Ah, DHL. Underrated.
Very, highly underrated. that's why I love buying from the international stores.
Yeah.
You shop from Essence.
Yeah.
Goodhood. Matches. Mm-hmm. You get your package in 2 days.
DHL tops. Don't play.
They don't.
They don't play.
And it's usually free international express shipping from these guys. It's wild.
Now, don't try and ship it back.
No. Yeah. That is.
You're fucked.
Well, no. With Matches and Essence, returns are free.
Is that right?
That is correct.
Oh, yeah, okay. That's true.
Some of the other ones, like Goodhood, End.
End. They fucked me.
There are a couple. Definitely read. Definitely go in there and read. Yeah, there are a couple places that will make you ship
that's
it.
That's my
pay
fault, though.
Pay for shipping back.
Yeah, but it was a pair of shoes, and it was going to be like $150 to ship back.
Yeah. Yeah. Anything to add? Do you have any bad experiences buying or selling? Do you?
No, I was going to add, when we were talking about bags, like, I'll never forget back in the day when I'd order shit from Urban Outfitters, because when you live in Beaumont, there's nowhere to shop except online. The Urban Outfitters package was those bags that were recyclable, and it looked like they were in the warehouse, like, tossing it around. And like kicking it around, like playing a game with it before it got even into the bag to be shipped to you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like the shirt would be like in the corner of the bag. You know?
Yeah.
And I was okay with it.
Yeah. I mean, you have the added benefit of like at least knowing it's new.
Yeah.
Right.
And it's Urban Outfitters. You want to have a little grunge in there.
That's true. That's true. Very important for the, get the whole experience.
Oh yeah.
All right, man. That's that wraps up my today's lecture.
Great info, man.
You can of course hop in the Discord if you have more questions. Hit us on the DMs on the Grom.
Add me on the Grom.
At Club Cool Pod. You can follow me at Barrett Dudley. Phil is at Piba Tag. And what's going on with the real estate, man? You sell any houses this week?
No, we're my client's coming back in town, so I'm trying to get some options together to look at.
Mm-hmm.
Inventory is dramatically low right now.
Okay.
There's been some good ones that have been snatched up though.
Yeah. A house down the street from us
was
just recently listed.
Yes.
For an absolutely shocking price.
And did it sell?
I mean, it's been on the market for 3 days, so I don't think so. But
that's good for you, man. Taxes are going to go up, but your resale will be nice.
Yeah, but you want a healthy medium there, because if that's actually the going rate, then we're never going to be able to move anywhere else.
That's true.
You know what I mean?
That's what's so shocking about this town.
It's
shocking.
We do not live in like a bougie ass neighborhood. And the price on this house is pretty,
would suggest
that we do.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's what's shocking about this town, Barrett. The price per square foot does not, I'm not talking luxury properties, but that's a whole other conversation. But for normal, nice single family homes, the price per square foot does not compute for the town that we live in.
Yeah.
And the location of some of these homes.
This house, by the way, this house. Now we're just getting into to very local.
Love it.
Nobody will understand what I'm saying. This house backs up onto a busy street.
Uh huh.
Across the fence from the backyard.
Yeah.
Is a very busy street.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Look, they're playing into the low inventory, high demand.
Right.
People will make sacrifices.
Yeah.
They'll say fuck it. The we can deal with the street.
I continue to blame the Californians.
You should.
I truly believe that that's what that is the biggest cause.
That's not unfounded.
Yeah.
In the luxury market, especially.
Oh, I'm sure.
Because they're trying to hold on to their cash.
Mm-hmm.
They're sick of California taxes.
Yep.
Their friends are moving here. That's the biggest thing. If you've got friends already, a network established in a town, it makes it so much easier.
Yeah.
We'll continue this conversation next week.
Come back next week for more house talk, more Austin specific real estate talk. We're a real estate podcast now. Any closing thoughts, Phil?
No.
All right. Thanks for being here. Everybody have a great weekend. Try to enjoy yourself. And we will be back soon. Check us out, patreon.com/clubcool. Definitely go check out today's sponsor, Hawthorne. Get yourself some beautiful grooming products, some great candles, some good face cleanser, some hand lotion. Buy all your gifts from Hawthorne. Check out their holiday deals, hawthorne.co. And we will see you guys next week. Bye-bye.
Adios.
Welcome to the club.